Good evening. It was a decade that began with Superman and ended with Batman, a decade in which, at the very least, comic book heroes learned not to wear their knickers outside their tights. But come, come, is that all that's changed? No, I think not. And tonight, in this cinematic survey of the 80s, I'll be touching on some of the ways in which the cinema has altered and grown up over the last 10 years. But let's begin with 1989 and my choice, in order neither of merit nor chronology, of the best 10 films of this year. If I start with Working Girl, in which Melanie Griffith made her way from secretary to business executive, with a lot of help from Harrison Ford and much hindrance from Sigourney Weaver, it's partly because it showed a shift in attitude.
Tequila gold.
Tequila.
Yeah. I promised myself that when we met, we'd drink tequila. No Chardonnay, no frog water. Real drinks. These things are usually so boring.
I wouldn't know.
Power to the people.
The little people. Oh, boy.
You okay?
I'm fine. I'm just fine. I took a antihistamine before, and it just got a nice little buzz.
Wow. I didn't know they let bad girls into these things.
Do I look like I don't belong here?
No. No, I'm sure you're a real ace. And whatever it is that you do.
Damn straight.
But how you look.
I have a head for business and a bod for sin. Is there anything wrong with that?
No.
Essentially, this is a romantic comedy and a very good one, but it's significant because it's the woman's career that matters. The man is a satellite. His job depends on her. 7 years ago, in An Officer and a Gentleman, it was very different. Deborah Winger had to look to Richard Gere to rescue her from the factory conveyor belt. But gradually things changed. In Broadcast News, Holly Hunter was the hotshot TV producer, better than all the men. In Baby Boom, which admittedly wasn't up to much, Diane Keaton played the single parent who built a little commercial empire. And in nearly all her films since The French Lieutenant's Woman in 1981, Meryl Streep has been the dominant character. Well, perhaps these and others are straws in the wind. Movies have been constructed around women before. But it's encouraging that the decade should end with at least one big picture that recognises woman's equality in the masculine world of commerce. More encouraging still is the contrast between Brian De Palma's luridly distasteful Dress to Kill in 1980 and The Accused in 1989. In the former, woman was the victim, an object to be brutalised, raped and slaughtered. In the latter, which dealt with rape and its aftermath, and gained Jodie Foster the Oscar for Best Actress, the victim fought back and won, a salutary reminder to men in general, and filmmakers in particular, that a woman's body is hers, to be used as she and only she wants to use it. And that leads me on to the second of my top 10 for this year, Sex, Lies and Videotape, an astonishingly accomplished first feature by Steven Soderbergh, which examined and indeed dissected the hypocrisy of contemporary sexual relationships.
Tell me why, Graham. Why?
What do you want me to tell you? Tell me why? Why? Anne, you don't even know who I am. You don't have the slightest idea who I am. Am I supposed to recount all the points in my life leading up to this moment and then just hope that it's coherent, that it makes some sort of sense to you? It doesn't make any sense to me. You know, I was there. I don't have the slightest idea who I am. I'm supposed to be able to explain it to you. And why? Tell me why. Why do I have to explain myself to you?
Because maybe I can help you.
Help me with what?
Your problem.
My problem? Do I have a problem? I look around me in this town and I see John and Cynthia and you and I feel comparatively healthy.
You've got a problem.
You're right.
One of the more engaging and novel aspects of Sex, Lies and Videotape was its assertion that it's okay not to be actively involved in sex, that it's not a competition with everybody's strike rate notched up on a scoreboard. Talking about it, discussing motivation and consequences is all right too. No doubt the menace of AIDS has had much to do with that shift in thinking, which was also reflected this year in When Harry Met Sally. The question posed here was whether it was possible for a man and a woman to bypass the bonking and merely be friends. It decided not, and probably it was right, but at least it was a question worth asking. It's interesting too that the darker side of sex, the effect as well as the cause of what the cinema has habitually treated as an adult game, a stimulating and relaxing pastime if you like, has lately come in for attention. In 1988, Fatal Attraction, for instance, put adultery into disrepute, and Dangerous Liaisons, the third of my films of the year, was a chilling study of sexual power politics set in 18th century France. Glenn Close and John Malkovich were the conspirators plotting the corruption of Michel Pfeiffer.
How is Belrosh?
I'm very pleased with him.
And is he your only lover?
Yes.
I think you should take another. I think it most unhealthy, this exclusivity.
You're not jealous, are you?
Of course I am. Belrosh is completely undeserving.
I thought he was one of your closest friends.
Exactly. So I know what I'm talking about. No, I think you should organize an infidelity. With me, for example.
You refuse me a simple favor, then you expect to be indulged?
It's only because it is so simple, it wouldn't feel like a conquest. I have to follow my destiny. I have to be true to my profession.
All right, then. Come back when you've succeeded with Madame de Tourvel.
Yes.
And I will offer you a reward.
Now, it's all very well for me to rattle on here about my favourite films of the year, but what were your favourites? Well, I'm glad you asked that because I'm about to tell you. Here, then, is the list of the top 10 movies at the box office in 1989. Ten was Cocktail, New York barman Tom Cruise, shaken but not stirred as he charmed his way to the top. At nine, Dead Poets Society, Robin Williams inspired as both actor and teacher as he gave lessons in life, love and literature. Eight, Twins, courtesy of the lookalike casting agency, Danny DeVito and Arnold Schwarzenegger as twin brothers separated at birth. 7, Lethal Weapon 2, Lean, Mean and Clean, Gibson and Glover save society from going down the pan. At 6, License to Kill, Bad Guys, Bad Girls and Timothy Dalton as the world's best-known three-figure number. 5 was The Naked Gun, quickfire comedy and deadpan puns in a splendidly silly spoof. 4, Rain Man, Dustin Hoffman and Tom Cruise in a moving exploration of autism and intelligence. 3 was Batman, dynamic duo Keaton and Nicholson in the film of the t-shirt of the comic strip. Number 2, Who Framed Roger Rabbit? Hoskins and Roger as a latter-day Bogart and Bugs in Toontown. For the number 1 picture, Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, keeping up with the Joneses in pursuit of the Holy Grail. Now, what pleases me there is that despite all the hype, Batman didn't make it to the top. And I'm pleased only because it didn't deserve to. For all its brilliant design and special effects and Jack Nicholson's outrageous performance, it was a very disappointing film. So let's look above it in the list. The number one spot is occupied by Steven Spielberg, the director, with Indiana Jones. And at number two, there's Steven Spielberg, the producer, with Who Framed Roger Rabbit. And that's appropriate because in both capacities, Spielberg, who's reputed to earn $100,000 a day, 7 days a week, what? No double bubble for the poor chap on Saturdays and Sundays. He's been, without question, the most influential filmmaker of the decade. 4 of his pictures, headed by E.T., are among the 10 biggest money earners of all time. Now, this has made him enemies. His work, either as producer or director, with its powerful appeal to the young and the young at heart, has been blamed by many distinguished filmmakers for what they call the juvenilization of the movies, the plethora of inferior pictures aimed cynically at teenage audiences. But that's not his fault. The blame lies with his imitators, whose gross and often witless horror and space flicks and tedious tales of adolescent growing pains have been one of the biggest blights on the 80s. Spielberg himself is a fine and, I believe, an honest filmmaker, and Indiana Jones and The Last Crusade, with inevitably Harrison Ford as Indy and, surprisingly, Sean Connery as his dad, was easily the best of 1989's adventure capers.
What do the Nazis want with you, Dad?
They wanted my diary.
Yeah?
I knew I had to get that book as far away from me as I possibly could.
Yeah.
Dr. Jones.
Yes? Yes?
I will take the book now.
What book?
You have the diary in your pocket.
You don't. Do you think my son would be that stupid that he would bring my diary all the way back here?
You didn't, did you? You didn't bring it, did you?
Well,
you did.
Look, can we discuss this later? I should have mailed it to the Marx Brothers.
Will you take it easy?
Take it easy? Why do you think I sent it home in the first place? So it wouldn't fall into their hands.
I came here to save you.
Oh, yeah? And who's going to come to save you, Junior?
Now, before we move on, and apropos that last clip, consider this. If all had gone according to plan A, Rick in Casablanca would have been played not by Humphrey Bogart, but by Ronald Reagan. Now, I ask you, what kind of film would that have been? Precisely. It just shows that in the movies, plan A is not always the best plan. Well, here are some other more recent examples of how plan A has had to give way to plan B. Harrison Ford was not the first choice to play Indiana Jones. Tom Selleck was. Nice for Harrison, tough for Tom. What would Back to the Future have been like if Michael J. Fox had not replaced Eric Stoltz? Would When Harry Met Sally have been much different if Meg Ryan's role had gone as intended to Holly Hunter? Mind you, Batman probably turned out much the same with gorgeous pouting Kim Basinger instead of Sean Young. But imagine Beverly Hills Cop with no, not Eddie Murphy, but the original choice, Sylvester Stallone. And even worse, think of Tootsie without Dustin Hoffman and in his place, George Hamilton. Now, second thoughts are rather not. Instead, and with Hoffman in mind, let's turn to the next in my list of films of the year, Rain Man, in which the small but perfectly formed Dustin played the autistic older brother of the equally impressive Tom Cruise.
This is very serious, Ray.
Yeah, very serious.
You see, I have to get to Los Angeles, right? So you're gonna get on that plane. Do you understand me?
Yeah.
You're gonna have to get on a plane.
Yeah, get on a plane.
Yeah. Now, there's a Delta.
Yeah.
I mean, it leaves at midnight, Ray, you know, but Delta, how's Delta?
The Delta crashed August 2nd, 1985, Lockheed L-1011, Dallas-Fort Worth.
Right, right.
Terrible wind.
All airlines.
135 passengers.
All airlines have crashed at one time or another. That doesn't mean that they are not safe.
Qantas? Qantas never crashed.
Qantas?
Never crashed.
Well, that's...
Never crashed.
I mean, that's going to do me a lot of good, Ray.
Yeah.
You see, Qantas doesn't fly to L.A. out of Cincinnati. You have got to get to Melbourne.
Australia.
Melbourne, Australia, in order to get the plane that flies to Los Angeles. Do you hear me?
Canberra's a capital. 16.2 million population. It's very lovely beach.
Lunch. You and I are going to get on there.
Always strikes me as a perfectly natural reaction, that. Well, one aspect of Rain Man worth noticing is that it touched on the importance of the family, as did other recent films, Woody Allen's Hannah and Her Sisters, for example, and in its own bizarre way, Fatal Attraction. That, too, is in contrast to the earlier years of the decade, when such pictures as Kramer vs. Kramer and Ordinary People bleakly chronicled the breakup of the family. Apart from that, by providing Hoffman with his second Oscar of the 80s, Kramer having won him the first, it reinforced his position among the biggest stars of the last 10 years. The others, I would suggest, are Harrison Ford, Robert De Niro, William Hurt, Robert Redford, still just about clinging on, Michael Douglas, who made a late run, Meryl Streep, Sylvester Stallone, though he faded fast coming into the straight, and Eddie Murphy. Of these, Harrison Ford, playing both Han Solo and Indiana Jones, was the romantic hero of the decade, Streep the actress of the decade, and Eddie Murphy unquestionably the star of the decade. More than that, Murphy is the phenomenon of the decade. Since his debut in 1982, he's made 8 films which between them have grossed more than $1,000 million, and he's still not yet 29 years old. Now, when you look at some of his credits, The Golden Child comes rapidly and painfully to mind. It's deplorable that such rotten pictures should make so much money, but they do, because Murphy is the cinema's first black superstar, and he's done it on his own terms, not by being an Uncle Tom or any kind of white man's black man, but by being sharp, tough and streetwise in an unmistakably black American way and taking no crap from anybody. In previous decades, it would have been unthinkable that a black actor could become the biggest box office draw in the world, but that's what he is. And one can but hope that this is a sign that the cinema audience, if not the cinema itself, is becoming more mature. I just wish he'd make better films in future, that's all. But now, what are the stars of the next decade, the potential biggest names of 1999? Well, I offer the following, none of them unknown, but none of them quite established as yet. Kevin Costner, Tom Hanks, Tom Cruise, Tom Berenger, and on the distaff side, Meg Ryan and Michelle Pfeiffer. Argue it out among yourselves while I turn to the next of my films of the year, Kenneth Branagh's powerful, admirable version of Henry V.
Ayat resolves the governor of the town. This is the latest pall we will admit.
Therefore, to our best mercy, give yourselves, or like to men proud of destruction, defy us to our worst. For as I am a soldier, if I begin the battery once again, I will not leave the half-achieved Harfleur till in her ashes she lie buried. Therefore, you men of Harfleur, take pity of your town and of your people, whilst yet my soldiers are in my command, whilst yet the cool and temperate wind of grace o'erblows the filthy and contagious clouds of heady murder, spoil, and villainy. If not, why, in a moment, look to see the blind and bloody soldier with foul hand defile the locks of your shrill, shrieking daughters, your fathers taken by the silver beards and their most reverent heads dashed to the walls, your naked infants spitted upon pikes, whilst the mad mothers, with their howls confused, do break the clouds. What say you? Will you yield and this avoid? Or guilty in defense be thus destroyed?
Can't go too far wrong with dialogue like that, can you? Still, that brings us quite neatly to a consideration of Britain's performance in the 1980s. In some ways, we've done very well. Films like Chariots of Fire, Gandhi, The Killing Fields, Hope and Glory, A Fish Called Wanda, and many others have won critical or box office success, or both. In 1985, British film year, and the advent of multiplexes helped to boost annual cinema attendances by more than 50%. David Putnam became briefly, well, too briefly, alas, a Hollywood tycoon when he took over as head of Columbia Pictures. British directors like Alan Parker, Ridley and Tony Scott, and Adrian Lyne are firmly established as international filmmakers. But against that, investment in films made in this country fell from £270 million in 1986 to £126 million last year. And even more alarming, only 30 feature films, many of those intended basically for television, will have been made in this country in 1989. The story's been the same every year throughout the decade. The talent is here, the money is not. But let's have a look at our movie news report on the cinema in the 80s.
company had been bought by another company, effectively, and I didn't feel that the mandate that had been given when I came here could be operated.
Story of an entire decade in about 2 minutes flat. Oh, I should mention that this year David Lean triumphantly issued a re-edited extended version of Lawrence of Arabia, in which Omar Sharif took even longer to ride across the desert. Well, I suppose he would, wouldn't he? After all, he is 27 years older than when the film was first shown. Meanwhile, beyond the Atlantic, Hollywood took over the White House, a less than Oscar-winning performance by R. Reagan, and Carmel, where C. Eastwood at least deserved a nomination. And too, prompted by Coppola's Apocalypse Now, Hollywood began to pick vigorously at the sores of Vietnam. I don't mean the Rambo movies, which ludicrously rewrote history to give America a win on points, but serious pictures like Oliver Stone's Platoon and Kubrick's Full Metal Jacket, as well as others not really in the same league, such as Hamburger Hill, which portrayed the unpleasant reality rather than the fantasy of the war. If all that was a sign of growing maturity, then so were the furious attacks on racism, which featured in such films as Richard Attenborough's Cry Freedom, Chris Menge's A World Apart, Costa Gavras's Betrayed, and even Lethal Weapon 2, wherein the South African heavies were quite as nasty as the Nazis used to be. But this year's best film on the racial theme was Alan Parker's Mississippi Burning, about the murder of civil rights workers in the 1960s. Its emphasis on white involvement, the stars were Gene Hackman and Willem Dafoe, annoyed black America, but it was an extremely fine movie.
Where does it come from, all this hatred?
You know, when I was a little boy, there was an old Negro farmer lived down the road from us, named Monroe. And he was, I guess he was just a little luckier than my daddy was. He bought himself a mule. That was a big deal around that town. My daddy hated that mule, because his friends were always kidding him about, oh, they saw Monroe out plowing with his new mule, and Monroe was going to rent another field now they had a mule. And one morning, that mule just showed up dead. They poisoned the water. And after that, there was never any mention about that mule around my daddy. Just never came up. One time we were driving down the road and we passed Monroe's place and we saw it was empty. He just packed up and left, I guess, gone up north or something. I looked over at my daddy's face and I knew he'd done it. He saw that I knew. He was ashamed. I guess he was ashamed.
Well, so far, and perhaps inevitably, the concentration here has been on English language films. But that's not to overlook the large number of extremely good pictures that have come to us during the decade from other lands and in other tongues. Let me remind you simply to name a few of them, of Jean de Florette and Manon des Sources, Babette's Feast, My Life as a Dog, Mephisto, Kaikamusha, and the amazing, horrifying Shoah. I could go on and on, but I won't, because this programme has to end sometime. Instead, I'll direct your attention to the next in my list of films of the year, Pelé the Conqueror, which starred Max von Sydow in the story of an immigrant Swedish worker and his young son in Denmark at the turn of the century.
Ben. That's you. Yeah, I did a small company for this idag. Thing, you know, really a svenska smultron.
Hur långt
är det
till Amerika från?
Amerika. Ja, det är långt. Det är en farligt stor ocean emellan.
Erik säger att havet är det stärkaste som finns. Selv om det är blött, så kan det bära allting upp. Sten och järn och sådant.
Ja.
Vet om landene. Amerika. Kina. om de står på havets bund, eller om de svømmer rundt. Ellers kunne de jo være svære at finde.
Nej, de står nu stålet på botten, kan jeg tænke.
For at least the first half of the decade, the bulk of the cinema audience, certainly in America, was aged between 12 and 24, and it was in pandering to these customers that the movies reached a kind of nadir, the juvenilization that I mentioned earlier. For too long, the cinema was a place your brain refused to visit. No, no, it would say, you go ahead, I'll stay home and read a book. But in the last couple of years, America's baby boom generation has entered its 30s, and finding it has cash in its pocket has rediscovered an interest in the movies. The average age of the audience has gone up, and so have its expectations. Increasingly, I think, people are looking for films that will move their minds out of neutral, hence the success of Field of Dreams, which was about caring, about the need to dream, about man's yearning for a second chance. Even more notably, there was Dead Poets Society, with Robin Williams as the schoolteacher who taught his pupils to put love, life, and what they believed in above material gain and what the world regards as success. It would be nice, but probably over-optimistic, to think that his catchphrase, carpe diem, or seize the day, might become the slogan of the 90s.
A sonnet by Byron might score high on the vertical, but only average on the horizontal. A Shakespearean sonnet, on the other hand, would score high both horizontally and vertically, yielding a massive total area, thereby revealing the poem to be truly great. As you proceed through the poetry in this book, practice this rating method. As your ability to evaluate poems in this manner grows, so will your enjoyment and understanding of poetry.
Excrement. That's what I think of Mr. J. Evans Pritchard. We're not laying pipe, we're talking about poetry. How can you describe poetry like American Bandstand? Well, I like Byron, I give him a 42, but I can't dance to him. Now, I want you to rip out that page. Go on. Rip out the entire page. You heard me. Rip it out. Rip it out! Go on. Rip it out!
Thank you, Mr. Dalton. Gentlemen, tell you what, not just tear out that page, tear out the entire introduction. I want it gone. History, to leave nothing of it. Rip it out, rip! Be gone, J. Evans Pritchard, PhD. Rip, shred, tear, rip it out! I want to hear nothing but ripping of Mr. Pritchard.
Okay, well, so far we've talked about the best films of 1989, but what about the best films of the decade? Now, that should really start some arguments going. So here's my choice, again, not in order of merit, but in a rough chronological order. I'll start with Spielberg's magical E.T., the best of all science fantasy pictures. Then there's Bill Forsyth's Gregory's Girl, that most charming and joyous evocation of early adolescence. And to them, I would add Martin Scorsese's, and give him his due, Robert De Niro's riveting study of the boxer Jake LaMotta in Raging Bull. Have a look at those three first.
Remember the goblin?
You're so lame, Elliot.
Come on, Michael, he came back.
He came back? Oh, my God!
One thing. I have absolute power. Say it. Say it!
What have you got? Is it the coyote?
No. Look. Okay. Now, swear it. The most excellent promise you can make. Swear as my only brother on our lives.
Don't sit so heavy. I swear.
Okay, stand over there. And, you'd better take off your shoulder.
What?
You might scare him. And, close your eyes.
Don't push it, Elliot.
I'm not coming out there until your eyes are closed.
Okay, they're closed. I'm just gonna kill you.
Okay, swear it one more time. I have absolute...
You have absolute power.
Yes.
I'm sorry you missed lunch.
It's okay. Lunch means nothing to me. Some nuts, some fresh fruit.
Double apple pie and custard?
That kind of thing.
I'm off for a shower.
Dorothy! I just wanted to say, any time. For more practice, any time.
Right, ta.
Also, would you like to come out with me?
Okay.
I mean, in a kind of date.
I said okay.
Come on, stop fooling around. I mean, a real...
If you're going to argue about it, forget it.
No, no. Fine. When?
Tonight. 7:30 at the clock in the plaza.
Ready for the next batch? Well, here goes. Roland Joffe's and David Putnam's The Killing Fields, a harrowing and still timely examination of what the Khmer Rouge did to Cambodia. Then I pick Fanny and Alexander, Ingmar Bergman's last work for the cinema and a marvellously perceptive study of family life in turn-of-the-century Sweden, and Woody Allen's delightful exploration of family and other relationships in Hannah and her sisters.
Anything I eat's got to be absolutely dead. That's why I could never eat an oyster.
I read somewhere that they put that that lemon juice on them just to stun them. Yeah. What's the difference? Unconscious oysters just as horrible as the sucker wife.
See that?
What was it, a rocket?
I don't know. I saw a guy on a motorbike.
Sydney! Sydney!
Where have you been? I've been looking for you all over the city.
I left a message for you, Sydney. Didn't you
get it? I didn't get it. I took a cab.
There's a big accident right now.
What?
I think U.S. dropped many big bombs on LMCD.
U.S. bombs, you sure?
I think many, many dead. I don't know.
Does anybody else know about
nothing
it?
Nothing at all.
We're going.
Något som jag kanske får lov att berätta är att vi är morgontid här i huset. Så vi är vardag som söndag. Klockan 6 samlas vi till morgonbön i Edvards arbetsrum. Jag vill också nämna att vi bäddar våra sängar och städar våra rum själva. I det här huset härskar punktlighet, renlighet och ordning.
Bli inte förskräckta nu, barnsmå. Min dotter menar inte så illa som det kanske låter. I början tar vi allt från den skämtsamma sidan.
Jag förstår inte riktigt vad Blenda menar. Om avsikten är att införa någon sorts uppfostringsmetod.
Inte alls, kära lilla Emily. Inte alls. Jag är övertygad om att barnen själva så småningom kommer underfund med hur roligt det är att uppfylla sina plikter med omsorg. Jag menar närmast att allt samman ska vara som en lek.
Jag tror inte att mina barn uppskattar den sortens lekar. Inte jag heller förresten.
Det får väl framtiden utvisa, min kära Emily.
Mickey, what's the matter with you? You're all white.
I feel dizzy. You know, I don't feel well. Do you hear a ringing? Is there a ringing sound?
Yeah. I hear it.
No,
hello?
Not that.
Yeah. We're going to be working late tonight. No, we'll worry about it. It's all right. Yeah.
If I have a brain tumor, I don't know what I'm going to do.
You don't have a brain tumor. He didn't say you had a brain tumor.
No, naturally, they're not going to tell you because, well, you know, sometimes the weaker ones will panic if
but
you tell them.
But not you.
Oh, God. You were buzzing. Is there a buzzing?
Mickey, come on. We got a show to do.
I can't keep my mind on the show.
But there's nothing wrong with you.
If there's nothing wrong with me, then why does he want me to come back for tests?
He has to rule out certain things.
Like what? What?
I don't know. Cancer.
Don't say that. I don't want to hear that word. Don't mention that while I'm in the building.
But you don't have any symptoms.
I got the classic symptoms of a brain tumor.
2 months ago, you thought you had a malignant melanoma.
Naturally, I had the sudden appearance of a black spot on my back.
It was on your shirt.
I didn't know. Everyone was pointing back here.
Come on, we've got to make some booking decisions.
I can't think of it. This morning I was so happy, you know? Now I don't know what went wrong.
You were miserable this morning. We got bad reviews, terrible ratings, the sponsors are furious.
No, I was happy, but I just didn't realize I was happy.
How are you doing so far? Don't agree with any of them, right? Well, for my final batch, I give you Kurosawa's Ran, an extraordinary reworking of King Lear. My submission for the best thriller of the 80s, Peter Weir's Witness, in which, apart from anything else, Harrison Ford and Kelly McGillis prove that an erotic love scene can be played standing up and fully dressed. And John Huston's last film, The Dead, a beautifully evocative version of the James Joyce short story.
ただ この願いを聞いてくださるなら、この楓何も申しませぬ。悪逆非道については誰にも申しませぬ。卑怯未練な言葉も口には致しませぬ。これを話せばこの国は乱れに乱れまするぞ。いえ、この楓がこのようにして見せまする。 いかがじゃ、次郎殿。
He wanted to go to Galway with that Ivers woman.
What for?
Well, how do I know? To see him, perhaps.
He's dead. He died when he was only 17. Isn't it a terrible thing to die so young as that?
What was he?
He was in the gasworks.
I suppose you were in love with this Michael Fury, Greta.
I was great with him at the time.
What was it he died of so young? Consumption, was it?
I think he died for me.
So that's my list. If you don't like it, make your own. But, you know, sitting here with a new decade leering around the corner and holding, like every other decade, a carrot in one hand to reward us and a sandbag in the other to wallop us, It seems to me that the cinema is in a much better state than it was 10 years ago. It's a long way from perfect, God knows. It still pays too little attention to plot, characterization, and dialogue. It still talks down to an audience which it believes is unable to concentrate for more than 2 minutes at a time and can be fobbed off with the flash and empty techniques of the pop video. But I do believe there's a growing awareness that this must change, that an older audience will increasingly be a more demanding audience. Maybe that's just wishful thinking, though I do hope not. At least the omens are encouraging. For instance, I chose 10 films as my pick of 1989, but for the first time that I can remember, I could have chosen an entirely different 10 that would have been just as valid. And so, oh, hang on, if you've been paying attention, you'll have noticed that I've named only 9 films in both my pick of the year and my pick of the decade, and that's because the 10th choice completes both lists. It is, to keep you in suspense no longer, Peter Greenaway's The Cook, The Thief, His Wife and Her Lover. It's a film on which there's no middle view. You either love it or you hate it. And I include it now because it's a bold, astonishing piece of filmmaking, and because in its study of lust and greed and acquisitiveness, it delivers a truly savage condemnation of the me-first ethos that's been one of the most unattractive aspects of the 1980s.
What do you think you're doing? I'm telling a complete stranger intimate details about us.
It's not about us. It's about me.
It's about us! And what's all this? How much time you spend in that loo? And what's all this about a gynecologist? Who is he? It'd better be a she. I don't want some bloke fingering my wife about.
It's a man. He's Jewish. And he's from Ethiopia.
What?
His mother is a Roman Catholic. He's been in prison in South Africa. He's as black as the Ace of Spades, and he probably drinks his own pee.
Oh, yeah, you sense! You lying, ungrateful bitch, you get in that car. It's a dog ass for you, you bitch. Maggie, have you joined a colleagueus? Oh, bastard, you're a colleagueus. Get up!
So there you are. Thank you, 1980s. It's been great fun, but now so long and mind how you go. And hello, 1990s. What, I wonder, fingers crossed, have you got to offer? Well, no doubt we shall see. I'll be back on January the 9th with the first in the series of Film 90. But for now, I'll leave you with a final look at some of the movie moments of the 80s. Have a happy new year. Goodbye.
I was born to make you happy. It's just my style. Everywhere I go, telling everyone I know, baby, I love to see you smile. Don't want to take a trip to China. Don't want to sail up the Nile. Wouldn't want to get too far from where you are, 'cause I love to see you smile. In a world that's full of trouble, you make it all worthwhile. What would I do if I didn't have you? I love to see you smile. I love to see you smile.